Hi dear students, how are you? Fine? Okay. Today in this session, we are going to learn about the next topic, bryophytes. Last two lectures, we were learning about the introductory topic of the chapter, Plant Kingdom, and in that, we have completed the first topic, algae, and related to that, we have covered the three main classes of algae also. I think the topic is clear for you. You have prepared. The concept is clear. Okay, good. Now, next we are going to learn, that is bryophytes. Have you heard about bryophytes anywhere? It's okay, no problem. To a certain extent, the topic related to this classification you already learned in 9th and 10th standard. But only the difference is that what you have learned in 9th and 10th, that was only the basic topic. Now in 11th and 12th, the same topic you have to learn in detail. You have to go in depth. That's the only difference there. So bryophytes. Bryophytes include the various mosses and liverworts that are found commonly growing in moist shaded areas in the hills. Once again, see the point. Bryophytes include what? Various mosses and liverworts. Where they are found? They are found commonly growing in moist shaded areas in the hills. Figure is given. You can see here. Bryophytes in that liverwort, Merkantia. So female thallus is given. And male thallus is given. Mosses second, that is C figure, Funaria. So in that both gametophyte and sporophyte you can see in the same plant. And the next sphagnum, gametophyte is given. So here, now we are not going to discuss in detail regarding this. Whenever the topic connected to this is coming, so we will explain in detail. But one thing you have to remember, whatever figure is given in your MCQ test, whenever NEET is there, Gujarat there, what to be there, in that these figures can be asked for labeling the part, identify the part, for example, Archegonia 4, Antheridio 4, Gamma cup, Rhizoids. So whatever the figures given in the book, not only of this topic, any of the chapter, that you have to understand very clearly. It's very, very important. And if you are not expert in drawing, it's okay. But it should be scientifically correct. And the labeling should be correct. That will be the point regarding this diagram and labeling you have to remember. Anyhow, now we are going to learn about bryophytes. First point we have discussed, bryophytes include what? Various mosses and liverworts that are found commonly growing in moist shaded areas in the hills. Bryophytes are also called amphibians of the plant kingdom. Do you know what are amphibians? Yes. Can you give an example? Yeah, very good. Frog. So why we are calling them as amphibians? Amphi means dual. Bians means life. Actually, amphibians means they are having dual life. So in short, you have to understand they are able to live in both water and on land. But now here we are saying regarding the plant kingdom, and in that bryophytes are known as amphibians. So how they are known as amphibians of the plant kingdom? And the first point we discussed that they are found as growing where in moist shaded areas in the hills. That means we have to understand they are found in terrestrial on land. But now we are saying they are known as amphibians of the plant kingdom. Why they are known as such? Because these plants can live in soil but are dependent on water for sexual reproduction. So very, very important point we are discussing here. You have to underline the point. This question can be asked. Bryophytes are called amphibians. Why? So the reason is that because these plants can live in soil but are dependent on water for sexual reproduction. They usually occur in damp, humid and shaded localities. See the point? They usually occur in damp, humid and shaded localities. Damp means you have to understand slightly wet. They play an important role in ecological succession on bare rocks or soil. See here, damp word means you have to understand slightly wet. And they play an important role in plant succession on bare rocks or soil. This point you have to understand. I will explain you. But before that, once again, the first question we were discussing, that is bryophytes are also called amphibians of the plant kingdom. Why? The answer we discussed, because these plants can live in soil but they are dependent on water for sexual reproduction. So water is an inevitable part in their life cycle. Anyhow, they have to depend on water for what purpose? Sexual reproduction. So that regarding reproduction topic when it's coming, so we will discuss in detail. Now the next point we told that they play an important role in ecological succession. What do you mean by that? In ecology topic, in that unit, you will learn the same in detail. But now, please note down that point, ecological succession. Ready? Okay. Ecological succession is the process of change. Ecological succession is the process of change in the species structure of an ecological community over time. Once again, ecological succession is the process of change in the species structure of an ecological community over time. Full stop. The time scale can be decades. The time scale can be decades. Decades means 10 years. For example, after a forest fire. After a forest fire. Near about 10 years, it will get to convert or transform that area to become again a forest. So here the point once again, see the time scale can be decades or even millions of years after a mass extinction. The time scale can be decades or even millions of years after a mass extinction. So this you have to understand from the terminology ecological succession. Actually, what we are saying, on bare rocks or soil. So here you have to understand, one bare rock means nothing is on that, simply rock or soil. And then because of the continuous rain, heat and all, the rocks started withering, from that soil is developing. In that then small plants will grow. Then after slowly the number of plants increases, large trees are coming there, and slowly and gradually that area is converting into a dense forest. But anyhow, you have to understand the beginning was from a bare rock or a soil or such type of area. And the time scale can be of decades or a million of years after mass extinction. But anyhow, that structure of species community of that particular area is converting from one to another. That is known as ecological succession. So in the here, bryophytes are playing an important role in plant succession on bare rocks or soil. So very important point related to bryophytes. The plant body of bryophyte is more differentiated than that of algae. So we have completed algae. There even I told you that as compared to chlorophyceae, phaeophyceae, when came to brown algae, means the rhodophyceae, we were seeing the changes in age, differences in the structure, form, size, everything. So now as compared to algae, more differentiation we can see where in the case of bryophytes. So the plant body of bryophyte is more differentiated than that of algae. It is thallus-like and prostrate or erect and attached to the substratum by unicellular or multicellular rhizoids. What we are seeing here, they lack true roots, stem or leaves. As in the case of algae also we discussed that they are having simple plant body, thallus, thalloid, that means undifferentiated plant body is there, true root, stem, leaves absent there. But here we are seeing that they lack true root, stem or leaves, but they may possess what root-like, leaf-like or stem-like structures. So this is more differentiated than that of algae. Their undifferentiated plant body is there, but here what is their difference? What we are seeing? Root-like, stem-like, leaf-like structures we can see. So it is thallus-like and prostrate or erect and attached to the substratum by unicellular or multicellular rhizoids. They lack true root, stems or leaves. They may possess root-like, leaf-like or stem-like structures. So what do you understand by rhizoids? Write down. A filamentous outgrowth, rhizoids, a filamentous outgrowth or root hair, a filamentous outgrowth or root hair on the underside of the thallus, on the underside of the thallus in some lower plants, in some lower plants, comma, especially mosses and liverworts, especially mosses and liverworts serving, S-E-R-V-I-N-G, serving both, serving both to anchor the plant and to conduct water, serving both to anchor the plant and to conduct water. You can see the evolution, because as compared to algae, when we are telling about bryophytes, there we can see root-like structure, that is rhizoids. As in the case of higher level of plants, there the root function anchoring the plant and absorption of water and minerals from the soil. So here again you can see here this root also, what they are doing, anchoring the plant and even they are helping in conducting water. So once again see the point whether you have completed or not. Rhizoids, a filamentous outgrowth or root hair on the underside of the thallus in some lower plants, especially mosses and liverworts, serving both to anchor the plant and to conduct water. Done? It's clear for you? Okay. Now the next point. The main plant body of the bryophyte is haploid. What we are saying here? The main plant body of the bryophyte is haploid. It produces gametes. Hence it is called gametophyte. So gametophyte means you have to understand gamete producing plant body. So here the main plant body of bryophyte is haploid. It produces what? Gametes. And the sex organ in bryophyte are multicellular. The sex organs in bryophytes are multicellular. The male sex organ is called antheridium. They produce biflagellate antherozoids. You have to understand this point. Listen. What we are seeing, the main plant body of the bryophyte is which one? Haploid. It produces what? Gametes. And that's why it's known as what? Gametophyte. So the main plant body of bryophyte is haploid and it produces gametes, and that's why it's known as gametophyte. Gametophyte means you have to understand gamete producing plant body. And the sex organs in bryophytes are multicellular. Both the sex organs are there. Male sex organ is also there. Female sex organ is also there. The male sex organ is called antheridium. They produce what? Male gamete. And that male gamete, here it is known as antherozoids. How it's structured? They are biflagellated. So the male sex organ, which is multicellular, which produce male gamete, that is antherozoids, they are biflagellated, having two flagellae. The female sex organ called archegonium is flask shaped and produces a single egg. So what is the female sex organ known as? Archegonium. How its structure? It is flask shaped. What does it produce? It produces a single egg. The antherozoids are released into water where they come in contact with the archegonium. So the male gametes are released into the water where they come in contact with the archegonium. So here you have to understand the need of water in the case of sexual reproduction in bryophytes. And that was the reason we were calling them as what? Amphibians of the plant kingdom. So, what happens here? The antherozoids, they are biflagellated. So, obviously they can move, motile. So, these antherozoids are released into water where they come in contact with archegonium. An antherozoid fuses with the egg to produce the zygote. Already told that female sex organ is known as archegonium, which is flask shaped and produces a single egg. So this antherozoid, which is coming in contact with the egg, that produces what? Zygote. Because the fusion of male and female gamete results in the production of zygote. And these zygotes do not undergo reduction division immediately. So what is happening here? These zygotes do not undergo reduction division immediately. Usually what happens? The reduction division happens, but in here what happens? It's not undergoing reduction division immediately after the fusion, and they produce a multicellular body called a sporophyte. What happens? They produce a multicellular body called a sporophyte. The sporophyte is not free living but attached to the photosynthetic gametophyte and derives nourishment from it. Some cells of the sporophyte undergo reduction division, that is meiotic division, to produce haploid spores. These spores germinate to produce gametophyte. Once again, you have to listen. First, we told that
Androzoid fuses with the egg to produce zygote, and zygote does not undergo reduction division immediately. Instead of that, they produce what? A multicellular body called what? Sporophyte. And this sporophyte is not free living. And it is attached to the photosynthetic gametophyte and derives nourishment from gametophyte. And the sporophyte, which one is made, that is a multicellular body, from that some cells undergo reduction division and they produce haploid spores. And these spores germinate to produce again haploid gametophyte. Bryophytes in general are of little economic importance, but some mosses provide food for herbaceous mammals. What do you mean by herbaceous mammals? Means mammals that are herbivores. They are known as herbaceous mammals. So as compared to algae, that much importance is not coming in the case of bryophytes, but some mosses provide what? Food for herbaceous mammals, birds and other animals. Species of sphagnum, it is a moss that provide peat that have long been used as fuel and as packing material for transshipment of living material because of their capacity to hold water. Once again, listen here. As compared to algae, bryophytes are of little economic importance, but some mosses provide what? Food. For whom? Herbaceous mammals, birds and other animals. And some species of sphagnum, it's also a moss that provide peat that have long been used as fuel and as packing material. Why it is used as packing material? Because of water holding capacity. And where it was used mainly for the transshipment of living material. So here you have to understand what is peat. Please write down. An organic fuel consisting of spongy material formed by the partial decomposition of organic matter. Once again, an organic fuel consisting of spongy material formed by the partial decomposition of organic matter. Now we told that they are again used as packing material for transshipment of living material because of their water holding capacity. And what use we are getting because of that? And how it is beneficial? If rubbed with sphagnum, the material to be transshipped will be protected because sphagnum absorbs water. It won't allow water inside the material. So how it is useful in transshipment of living material? If the material is wrapped with sphagnum, and the material to be transshipped will be protected because sphagnum absorbs water, it won't allow water inside the material. Is it clear for you how sphagnum is useful and what is sphagnum? It's moss. Now mosses along with the lichens are the first organisms to colonize rocks and hence are of great ecological importance. Very, very important point. Because related to bryophytes, when we were explaining their beginning only, we told that they play an important role in plant succession on bare rocks and soil. Here the same point is repeating. Mosses along with the lichens. Lichen itself, you know that it's a combination or association of what? Algae and fungi. So here mosses along with the lichens, mosses, algae and fungi, that association, they are the first organisms to colonize rocks and hence are of great ecological importance. They decompose rocks, making the substrate suitable for the growth of higher plants. So how mosses along with the lichens are playing a very important role in ecological succession? What is its importance? What they are doing? So how they are working? They decompose. Who decompose? Mosses along with the lichens. They decompose what? Rocks, and making the substrate suitable for the growth of higher plants. Since mosses form dense mats on the soil, they reduce the impact of falling rain and prevent soil erosion. This is the next use. So what is another use? Since mosses form dense mats on the soil, they reduce what? The impact of falling rain and prevent soil erosion. This is another use of what? Bryophytes. Now the next point is coming. The bryophytes are divided into liverworts and mosses. Now we are going to learn about the division of bryophytes. But before that, once again we can have a quick review of the uses of bryophytes. First of all, we told that bryophytes in general are of little economic importance, but some mosses provide food for herbaceous mammals, birds and animals. Species of sphagnum, it is a moss that provide peat that have long been used as fuel, and even it is used as packing material for transshipment of living material because of their capacity of holding water. And the point we told next to that was, mosses along with the lichens are the first organisms to colonize rocks and hence are of great ecological importance. And they decompose rocks, making the substrate suitable for the growth of higher plants. Since mosses form dense mats on the soil, they reduce the impact of falling rain and prevent what? Soil erosion. The bryophytes are divided into liverworts and mosses.
So here now we are going to learn about division of bryophytes. As in the case of algae, we have learned about the division, how it was then mainly divided into three classes. Which were they? Yes, chlorophycine, pheophycine and rhodophycine. But here these bryophytes are divided into two, which are the liverworts and mosses. So let's move to the first, that is liverworts. From the name itself you can understand somewhat connected to liver, so might be the shape of leaf, what will be there. Let's see liverworts. Liverworts grow usually in moist, shady habitat such as banks of streams, marshy ground, damp soil, bark of trees and deep in the woods. Deep in the woods means we have to understand in the dense forest, inside the deep means where the light little bit penetrate. The liverworts grow usually in moist, shady habitats such as where banks of streams, marshy ground, damp soil, bark of trees and deep in the woods. The plant body of a liverwort is a thalloid. Do you remember what is thalloid or thallus? Yes. What is it? An undifferentiated plant body is not having a true root, stem and leaf. So here also it is like that. What we are seeing here, the plant body of a liverwort is thalloid. For example, Merkantia. What is an example? Example is Merkantia. In the figure 3.2, you can see bryophytes or liverwort. In that first figure is Merkantia. Female thallus is also given and even male thallus is also given. Even in MCQ questions, otherwise for the NEET exam, whenever you are going to appear for that, these part of the questions can be asked where this diagram can be given. It can be asked for labeling. So you have to understand which one is an archegoniophore and which one is an anthidiophore, and the gamma cup structure is given. So we are going to learn it detail of the same. Here, what we are saying? The plant body of a liverwort is thalloid. Example, Merkantia. The thallus is dorsiventral. Means you have to understand dorsiventral word means dorsally and ventrally, or upper and lower. They are closely oppressed to the substrate. Means dorsally and ventrally attached or pressed to the substratum or the surface. That is the meaning. Dorsally and ventrally attached to the substratum. The leafy members have tiny leaf-like appendages in two rows on the stem-like structures. So here in the figure again you can see their funeria is given. It's a gametophyte and sporophyte, both are given there. And the next is sphagnum, which one we told about the fuel and transshipment. Everywhere this example was given. So sphagnum figure is given. You can see the leaves, how it is arranged there. So we are not saying that they are stem, but in two rows on the stem-like structure, leaf-like appendages are arranged. You can see here in funeria, you can see the same. And in sphagnum also you can see them. But we are not saying that they are the true root or true stem or true leaf like that. But leaf-like appendages arranged in two rows on stem-like structures. We are not saying they are the stem or they are the leaf. This you have to understand. That's why the plant body is known as a thallus or thalloid. So first paragraph is clear for you. First you have to understand where is the habitat. They grow usually where? In moist, shady habitats such as banks of streams, marshy ground, damp soil, bark of trees and deep in the woods. And how the plant body? The plant body of a liverwort is how? It's of thalloid. Example, Merkantia. And the thallus is how? It's dorsiventral and closely oppressed to the substrate. And the leafy members have tiny leaf-like appendages in two rows on the stem-like structures. Asexual reproduction in liverworts take place by the fragmentation of thalli. So now coming to the topic, that is of reproduction point, you have to understand asexual reproduction is happening and that is by fragmentation of thalli. Thalli is the plural of thallus, or by the formation of specialized structures called gamete. Singular is gamma. What we are saying? Asexual reproduction in liverworts takes place by fragmentation of thalli. So one process in asexual reproduction, that is fragmentation. And the another one is by the formation of specialized structures called what? Gamete. And the singular is gamma. And gamete are green multicellular asexual buds. The question can be asked, what are gamete? So how we can define that? Underline the point. Gamete are green multicellular asexual buds which develop in small receptacles called gamma cups. In the diagram, the figure which one is given, you can see that it is labeled their gamma cup. So here you have to understand, gamete are green multicellular asexual buds which develop in small receptacles called what? Gamma cups. So what are gamete? They are the specialized structures in the asexual reproduction of what? Liverworts. And where they are developing? They are developing in special receptacles called gamma cups, and they are located on the thalli. The gamete become detached from the parent body and germinate to form new individuals. So this gamete, they are detaching from the parents. That means they are separating from the parent's body and germinate to form new individuals. So this is regarding asexual reproduction in liverworts. One process, that is, what is that? Yes, that is by fragmentation of thalli. And another one, by the formation of specialized structures in particular cup-like structure, that is known as gamete cup. They are known as gamete. And they are detaching from the parental body and growing or germinating as the new individuals. Now regarding sexual reproduction, during sexual reproduction, male and female sex organs are produced either on the same or on different thalli. So coming to the point of sexual reproduction, what we have to understand, during sexual reproduction, male and female sex organs are produced either on the same or on different thalli. The sporophyte is differentiated into a foot, cita and capsule. It's a very important point. The sporophyte is differentiated into a foot, cita and capsule. After meiosis, spores are produced within the capsule. These spores germinate to form free living gametophytes. So what we are seeing here, the sporophyte is differentiated into a foot, cita and capsule. After meiosis, spores are produced within capsule and these spores germinate to form free living gametophytes. Means haploid gametophyte is produced from that. So this is related to liverworts. Now one more is there, that is mosses. The predominant stage of the life cycle of moss is the gametophyte. The dominant stage or the predominant stage of the life cycle of a moss is what? Gametophyte, which consists of two stages. The first stage is the protonema stage, which develops directly from a spore. So what we are seeing here, very important point is coming here. Anyhow, we are saying that to complete the life cycle of a plant, it has to go through what? Haploid gametophytic generation and diploid sporophytic generation. In the case of mosses, when we are seeing the predominant stage, we have to understand, in their case, the haploid gametophytic phase is the predominant stage and it has two stages. The first stage is the protonema stage, which develops directly from a spore. So the direct stage which is developing from spore, it is known as the first stage, which is known as protonema stage. It is a creeping, green, branched and frequently filamentous stage. So what we are seeing here, in the case of first stage of moss, which developed directly from spore, is known as protonema, which is a creeping, green, branched and frequently filamentous stage. And the second stage is the leafy stage, which develops from the secondary protonema as a lateral bud. So from the protonema, which is the first stage, from that laterally which branch is developing, that is known as what? Leafy stage, that is the second stage. They consist of upright, that means straight, slender axis bearing spirally arranged leaves. So in the figure you can see it very clearly. In the case of mosses, in the figure C and D, in the C you can see both gametophyte and sporophyte, both are given. Sporophyte, there you can see the part cita and capsule, and that is depending on the gametophyte for the nourishment. And the leaves arrangement, how it is done, spirally arranged leaves you can see there. So here what we are seeing, this leafy stage, which is the second stage, which develops from the secondary protonema as a lateral bud, they consist of upright slender axis bearing spirally arranged leaves. They are attached to the soil through multicellular and branched rhizoids. So rhizoids, what means, you have to understand the structure, root like structure, that is known as rhizoids. So here what we are seeing, they are attached to the soil through multicellular and branched rhizoids. This stage bears the sex organs. So the second stage bears what? Sex organs. So first paragraph, what we have to understand, the predominant stage of the life cycle of moss is the gametophyte, which consists of two stages. The first stage, which directly develops from the spores, is known as what? Protonema. And how it is? its creeping green branch and frequently filamentous stage. And the second stage is known as the leafy stage, which develops from where? From the secondary protonema, how? As a lateral bud. And what do they consist? They consist of upright slender axis. Axis is the plural of axis. They bearing spirally arranged leaves. They are attached to the soil through what? Multicellular and branched rhizoids. You can see in the diagram, rhizoids is labeled there. In the case of Funaria, you can see that very clearly. And this stage bears what? Sex organs. Now coming to the reproduction part, vegetative reproduction in mosses is by fragmentation and budding in the secondary protonema. In the case of liverworts, we told that one of the method that was of means by fragmentation of thalli only. Here also it's by fragmentation in the case of mosses. And another one we told in that case, that was of the formation of specialized structures known as gamete, in particular gamete cup. Here we are saying that is budding, and that also where? In the secondary protonema. In sexual reproduction, the sex organs antheridia and archegonia. Antheridia is the plural of antheridium and archegonia is the plural of archegonium. And where they are produced? At the apex, apex means tip of the leafy shoots. After fertilization, the zygote develops into a sporophyte. Again, you have to see the diagram, and it is labeled in that sphagnum. You see the page number, what is given here, 34. There you can see mosses in that C. Funaria and the D. sphagnum. In the case of sphagnum, what is labeled there? Branches are there, and then antheridial branches and even archegonial branch. So what we are seeing the point here, what happens related to sexual reproduction when we are saying about mosses, what happens in sexual reproduction, the sex organs, which one? Antheridia and archegonia. Where they are produced? They are produced at the apex of the leafy shoots. And after fertilization, what happens? The zygote develops into a sporophyte consisting of what? A foot, seta and capsule. And the sporophyte in mosses is more elaborate than that in liverworts. As compared to liverworts, more elaborate structure is having of sporophyte in mosses. The capsule contains spores. Spores are formed after meiosis. The mosses have an elaborate mechanism of spore dispersal. Common examples of mosses are Funaria, Polytrichum and Sphagnum. So which are the common examples of mosses? Funaria, Polytrichum and Sphagnum. Example of liverwort? Yes, Mercantia. Okay. So here we have discussed about two divisions of bryophytes, liverworts and mosses. In mosses again we told that the predominant life cycle of moss is what? Gametophyte. And but it has two stages. First stage protonema and second stage leafy stage. Then we have told about regarding the reproduction of them. In that case, vegetative reproduction is by what? Fragmentation and by budding. And in the sexual reproduction, sex organs are developed where? In the antheridia and archegonia, which are produced at the apex of leafy shoots. Then after fertilization, what happens? The zygote develops into a sporophyte consisting of what? Foot, seta and capsule. The sporophyte in mosses is more elaborate than that of what? Liverworts. The capsule contains spores. The spores are formed after meiosis. The mosses have an elaborate mechanism of spore dispersal. Common examples of mosses are Funaria, Polytrichum and Sphagnum. Today in this session we are going to learn this much only there. And in the next session, in the next lecture, we will learn about these bryophytes in detail from the material. But before that, you have to do the preparation nicely. Whatever topics we have completed, you have to learn and come. I'll ask some questions to you related to these topics there before starting from the material. Thank you so much.